Good evening, everyone. Very warm welcome to St. James this evening for our service of Holy Communion. Whether you're gathered here in the building or joining our worship online today, a very warm welcome to you. Everything that you will need for our time together will be in these service sheets. And as we come to God this evening, as we gather in God's name, he welcomes us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's sit together as we come in prayer to our God this evening. And let's join together in the prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We come to God today as one from whom no secrets are hidden, to ask for his forgiveness and peace. And so we pray together. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I invite you to join me in standing as we praise God in the words of the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let's sit as we pray together.
Almighty God, whose only Son has opened for us a new and living way into your presence, give us pure hearts and steadfast wills to worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Rachel's very kindly going to bring us our first reading for this evening. Thank you, Rachel.
The first lesson is taken from Proverbs chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. A good name is to be chosen rather than great riches, and favour is better than silver or gold. The rich and the poor have this in common. The Lord is the maker of them all. Whoever sows injustice will reap calamity, and the rod of anger will fail. Those who are generous are blessed, for they share their bread with the poor. Do not rob the poor because they are poor, or crush the afflicted at the gate. For the Lord pleads their cause and despoils of life those who despoil them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading comes from the letter of James, chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, have a seat here, please, while to the one who is poor you say, stand there or sit at my feet. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters, has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that has been promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into the courts? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Our Gospel reading this evening comes from Mark chapter 7, beginning to read at verse 24. From there Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile, of Syro-Phoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre, and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee, in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then, looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one. But the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please have a seat, everyone. May I speak today according to the will of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, in our Gospel reading this evening from Mark chapter 7, we meet Jesus on his day off. He slipped, he thinks, unnoticed north into non-Jewish territory where Jews like himself would never ordinarily go. And Jesus has this conversation with a Syro-Phoenician woman, a non-Jewish woman, and it comes at a key moment in the Gospel of Mark. Just before this chapter, we've had the feeding of the 5,000, and just after this chapter, we're going to have the feeding of the 4,000. The feeding of the 5,000 takes place in Jewish territory, and there are 12 baskets of leftovers. Those numbers, 5 and 12, are significant. The number 5 would make people think of the 5 books of the law, the books of Moses, at the beginning of the Bible. And 12 is the number of the tribes of Israel. So everything about the feeding of the 5,000 is underlining that Jesus is ministering among Jewish people. When we fast forward to the feeding of the 4,000, Jesus is in non-Jewish territory, in Gentile territory, and there are 7 baskets left over. Again, those numbers 4 and 7. In the ancient way of looking at the world, there were 4 corners of the earth. 7 reminds us of the 7 days of creation that we read about in Genesis before Israel is called through Abraham. And so in this sort of enigmatic meeting between Jesus and this woman, Mark is showing us that Jesus is not only the Messiah, the chosen one of the Jewish people, but that he is also the Saviour of the whole world. This woman, breaking every social convention going, comes to Jesus when he's trying to lay low unnoticed and asks him to heal her daughter. Jesus replies by saying, "The children must first be satisfied." And by this, he means that his mission, his ministry, is first to the Jews. Once they are satisfied, once they have received what God has to give them, then we can worry about the Gentiles. This woman points out that the God that Jesus embodies is so abundant, has so much to give the world, that the whole world could be fed just on leftovers, on crumbs. What Jesus shows in the feeding of the 5,000 just a few verses before, this conversation is making real in the life of this woman and her daughter. And from this point onwards in the gospel, Jesus not only brings healing and salvation to Jewish folk that he meets, but also to Gentiles. There is no way that God's grace and God's abundant life can be stopped or confined or just happen in one area. All these social, political, and religious barriers come crashing down. Jesus, and through Jesus, Israel itself is overwhelmed by the abundance of God. There is so much grace, so much forgiveness, so much eternal life. And the good news of Jesus is overflowing, glory upon glory. This woman, with her simple and persistent faith, is asking Jesus, is demanding for him to take the logic of God's kingdom to its ultimate conclusion. We might think that holiness is so often about keeping the boundaries policed, about keeping out what should be kept out. For people in Jesus' day, that meant get rid of the Romans who were occupying them, get rid of the impurity of the Gentiles who were not like them. But in this conversation between Jesus and this woman, we begin to see that holiness actually is all about crossing those boundaries, about demonstrating that there is no social distance between heaven and earth. Holiness, at its heart, is Jesus being with us, even in all the mess and the hurt and the darkness of life. And when Jesus is with us in that place, he turns those things into new life, into resurrection. What bearing does this conversation have for us as we gather here today? Well, first of all, I believe that these verses show us that God's glory is to be found in unexpected places, that God's wisdom and depth is to be found in unexpected places. Jesus even didn't expect such a clear statement of God's life and abundance and grace to come from some foreign woman who has accosted him on his day off. She's got no background in theology to speak of. Where do we expect to find God's grace and wisdom? In here or out there? When we read in our reading from the book of James that Chris shared with us about the instant judgments we make sometimes when people come through the door, how we show perhaps more favoritism to someone who looks like they've got their life together, but actually someone who is poor can be rich in faith. God's wisdom comes from the most unlikely place. Second of all, this passage shows us that we ourselves are also fed with the overflow of God's abundance, with the crumbs that fall from the table. Those gifts are given to us, and we are called to share what we receive. We are like this woman. We receive from God, and we celebrate that this evening as we share bread and wine together. This story is giving us a picture of the good news of God. But it's up to us how we hear that. If we assume that we are the people to whom Jesus comes first, our experience of God will be one of entitlement and responsibility. That is a stance I know that I take more often than I should. Do I try to put the lid back on what God is doing? Or do we allow ourselves to be like this woman, receiving the good news of astonished grace, that God has included even us in his story, has showered his healing and forgiveness and eternal life even on you. Once it begins, as we see from Mark's gospel, it doesn't stop. It goes to the region of Tyre and Sidon, all the way to Bulkington and beyond, forever and ever. Thanks be to God. Amen. Stand and declare our faith together using the words of the Creed on page 9 of our service sheets. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died,
Father God, we gather our thoughts and prayers with hope and humbly call on you to help in our need. Give your wisdom and heavenly grace to those who serve this diocese, especially Bishops Christopher and John, Reverend Charles, our readers Ken and Sue, and to all others who hold office in our church, that by their service, faith may abound and your kingdom increase. Lord, in your mercy, Creator God, we lift up the people of Afghanistan to you right now. We pray that you would take hold of them and help them walk through this fearful time. Protect them and help them feel the comfort and peace that only comes from your powerful presence. Lord, in your mercy, Creator God, we worship you as the one who has given us this life and ask that you will help us to live it to the full. At home, may we be the friends and neighbours that we really want to be. Help us to spread the warmth of your love to everyone we meet. We pray for those people who live and work in Larkin Close, Leicester Court and Leicester Road. We pray especially at this time for all students and teachers as their new term starts, and for those who are leaving the comfort and security of their family homes to begin the next chapter of their lives. Loving God, we pray for Freddie, who was baptized today and starts the journey of his Christian life. We pray for your blessing and guidance for Freddie's parents and godparents. Lord, in your mercy, Father God, we are reminded today of the need to reach out to others and treat them with dignity and respect. Help us to remember that everyone is equal, to value other people and to treat them well, just as we would wish to be treated. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Holy God, we lift before you those still burdened, those seeking healing, those in need within the church and the world, especially in these difficult times. The following in our community have asked for our prayers: Paul Towers, Margaret Whites, Anne McCreath, Pat Swift, Josie Bayliss, Molly Frost, June Quinney, Maggie Harris, Sheila Pike, Helena, Stephen and Evelyn. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we pray for those whose hearts have been saddened by the death of someone close and dear to them, for members of the families who have died, and those whose anniversary we recall. Help us to experience the comfort of the Holy Spirit within us and the fellowship of the church family around us until we are reunited once more in your heavenly kingdom. We name those who have departed recently: Andrew Thorpe, Roy Thorpe, Margaret Shilcock and Denise Wall. Lord, in your mercy, faithful God, we thank you for your wisdom, that your wisdom not only enlightens us but transforms us and guides us in our daily work through life, through our walk through life with you. As we go into another week, help us always to accompany our words of faith with deeds of action. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ.
Shall we stand to share the peace together? We celebrate today that Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Wherever we are, here or online, let's offer one another a sign of that peace. thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you with saints and angels praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, the broken bread and wine outpoured, may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. The night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them, and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it. In remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Let's sit together as we continue in prayer, and let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. So as we gather around the Lord's table to share in his gifts to us this evening, you are very welcome to come forward and to receive the bread or else a prayer of blessing if you would prefer. If you'd like to receive a blessing, if you just keep your hands by your sides, they'll know that's what you want as you come today. If you're joining our service online, then you might like to use the prayer of spiritual communion at the top of page 15. This evening, come to this table. Not because you must, but because you may. Not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Not because you have arrived, but because you are still on a journey. Come because you love the Lord a little and want to love him more. But above all, come because he loves you and gave himself for you. Let's join in the prayer after communion at the bottom of page 15. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Thank you so much, everyone, for being with us this evening, whether here in the building or online. It's been a joy to gather in God's presence with you. And just as we have a time of sharing notices together, we're going to begin by just giving to God the prayers on our prayer tree. Father God, we thank you for all the ways in which you are at work in the world and at work in people's lives. And we offer before you the situations and the people named on our prayer tree this month. We ask that you would bless all those who have come to you in prayer, and that you would work your healing and your life, both in this community and around the world. Amen. The first notice this evening is to say a massive thank you to May and the team that she organised yesterday that did such an amazing job cleaning up the church building, moving various things that we've had to relocate over the past few months of pandemic, and just generally giving the place a good spring clean. Thank you so much for all your efforts yesterday, for everybody that came along and was able to share in that task so joyfully, and serving God and one another. As we prayed in the prayers this evening, it's started to happen already, but just to remind you to pray for those starting a new term this week, especially starting new schools and new chapters of life. That would be wonderful if we could bring those people to God each day. The other notice is just to say that there is opportunity to contribute to our worship. One of the great gifts that we have as we gather together is having lots of different voices contribute to our services, particularly in reading the Bible and leading the prayers. If you'd like to be involved in either of those things, then please speak to myself, speak to May, or her email address is there, and there's plenty of support, plenty of training and resourcing that will accompany those roles going forward. So don't let lack of experience be a barrier to giving something a go. Shall we pray for God's blessing as we go out into a new week? The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you forevermore. Amen. Amen. Let's go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.